And the Bayelsa state government has cautioned the people of the state, particularly the youths, to maintain relative peace in the state despite the shortcomings of the Petroleum Industry Act recently signed into law by President Muhammadu Buhari. The government is also urging the Joy Youth Council to operate within the confines of its constitution and not delve into issues bordering on the election of traditional rulers. The deputy governor, Senator Lawrence Egrujakpo, made this known at a meeting with traditional rulers. He says he noticed that although what the people of oil-bearing communities expected from the Petroleum Industry Bill was not what they received from the act, there is still a need for them to promote peace and stability in the state.
Well, Arise analyst Dr. Sam Amadi actually joins us again to take a look at the PIA. And of course, Christian, you want to start this conversation?
Not from the oil producing area, anyway. Dr. Sam Amadi, there's been a lot of recriminations, you know, about the PIA. Not only by the oil-bearing communities, but the governors, the 36 state governors, have now joined the fray because they see a legal lacuna there that has taken federal monetary allocations from the Federation account for them to share. This is really bespeaking, should we say so?
Well, clearly, I mean, the governors have an issue there. But first, I think on the whole, the act is a good one. You know, okay. The trade-offs, so, you know, are enough to help reposition this sector again. Interesting that only all the money that came into Africa, West Africa, for example, even Africa, in terms of investment in the oil sector, Nigeria didn't have up to maybe 0.5%. Less came to us because of the fact that the transparency, the level of regulatory certainty is low. The fiscal regime is not encouraging. So this is why this new law is a must. But again, getting back to the governor's contention, the first thing, there are four crises in this sector. One is crisis of ownership, you know, the issues around fiscal resource control, the Petroleum Act, and the various, the Constitution seem to say clearly that the oil belongs to the federal government, the federation, not state. And so what we've seen with this act is that it has clearly made it clear that this is a federal ownership. First, the NNPC Limited is now fully owned by the federal government, not like federation in any sense. So what the governors are complaining have merit. The fact that clearly you have removed them from ownership and management, shareholding, and revenue allocation based from oil resources that ought to be, if you like, a federation resource up until now. So that's a real case. For example, what could they have done? Maybe the act should have created a trusteeship. The notion here is that you don't want to have political kind of ownership affecting corporate practice. And so oftentimes, when state and federal government co-own things, when it's needed for business decision, it's always problematic. So what they have done is to say this is corporatized in a manner that the federal government manages it. But again, they could have created a corporate trust that works for both federal and state government, so that somehow states get resources. So that's one issue that maybe in the implementation committee can work on to find a way to create that, you know, stakeholding that will not damage the corporate practice. Because otherwise, we can see a criminal.
Absolutely, because I was going to go in that direction. From what you have said, you agree with the governors that this might be an issue. So we foresee some legal actions being taken. Do you foresee a way where the Supreme Court might actually declare the PIA illegal due to the fact that it doesn't really, you know, go with the true federalism? At the end of the day,
The Supreme Court position will be based on two factors. One is the Supreme Court is also a governing political institution as well, in that sense, small p, meaning the Supreme Court is concerned also about the issues, economic issues, challenges about the sector. So if they can find a way to resolve that question without nullifying, they will be more tempted to resolve without nullification. Again, they can nullify part of that act if it's necessary without nullifying the act itself. So the issue around sharing of revenue could be an issue. Again, let's look at the host community framework. Now, people talk about the 4%, the 3% as maybe too small. Now, this 3% from studies is about $500 million,
yeah,
which is equivalent of the FCT budget. So the question then is, if you have a oil community support corporate governance that's equivalent of the budget of the FCT, is it enough or not? And the question again is this. What they have done is to say the law has mandated mandated corporate governance and has provided a framework. So I can argue that even though we have less, short of 5%, but the framework for using that money guarantees more impact. So at the end of the day, they're rent seeking around oil community support. For example, if you look at the Niger Delta, you discover that sometimes some projects are never completed because they were not properly procured. The cost benefits are not worked out and they don't implement them. So even those work for the oil companies themselves use the budget of the oil, the support for the communities to reach themselves at detriment of the community. Not just the community chiefs who probably, but even the corporate people. So with this structure, creates a transparent, accountable, auditable process that guarantees that it's project-driven. Some of us have argued that intervention ideas should be project-driven, not bureaucracy-driven. So we get NDDC putting money, a lot of money there, the payout.
And
if you look at the framework that says you can't spend up to X amount to manage that trust. So I think this is actually a win-win for everybody. Business gets clarity on investment and corporate governance. The committee have bankability that this is projects are going to be developed. Even if we don't get all this money, we get clarity that this project will complete. Again, you free the companies from incident conflict. With the
and
committee.
There'll be continuity. Mm-hmm. Okay, now let's look at the PIA against the backdrop of the 13% oil derivations to oil producing states. Nothing. Yeah. Again, is said about that.
Because this does not take away the 13% guaranteed.
Doesn't it?
It doesn't. This 13%
because 13% is a constitutional guarantee.
This is 3%
so this cannot override
that. So what this does is to bring all the projects that companies do for communities and bring them under a host community trust fund that is defined, project-based, and using the budget, previous budget, 3% of the previous expenditure of the year.
Sam, I think that would be taken away, you know, the monetary derivation from this 13% paid straight to states.
Remains. This is actually extra, you know, all these oil companies are supposed to do corporate governance. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And there's conflict around it, corruption around it. Mm-hmm. So what I've done
there's
is
no
say,
framework.
This
there's
is
no
what
framework.
You would do in a year. 0.3%, 3% of your as operating cost for the previous year will be their benchmark for what you're going to spend. Yeah. And this is a structure you're going to put in place for streamlining that. And this structure has participation of the community. But what happened here is that they appoint the trustee members themselves, and these projects are settled over time. If you look at another interesting part, some of the environmental pollution is because the government has commingled itself with operation that they cannot end flare. Now, this brings a regulatory process that says this flare will be ended because you're going to be penalized. And the penalty goes into another fund for intervention to address crisis. So if you look at it, and then the Frontier Exploration Basin. Fund, which is wrongly said to be probably Northern Nigeria, but if you look at the declared frontiers, about 2 out of 7 are in the south. The Anambra is the big one, Anambra Basin. Dahomey, which is the Lagos
close, is also part Lagos, of it.
And then the regulator has a capacity to declare over time these basins that will be part of that fund. And again, it's not the whole 30% of profit that comes. It's 30% of oil and gas profit, which means subsidiaries that are downstream and midstream, their profit are not part of it. So there are a lot of lack of clarity in this bill.
The PIA, experts would say it's a law that is put in place really to make the industry more profitable. Okay. But would this law really help to reset the sector and really improve the profitability and sustainability? Because the GMD was here on the Rise News. He's spoken in that direction. And even the Minister of State for Petroleum Resources is also saying, yes, this is what it intends to do. And do you agree with them?
I agree with them because what will hold back investment, and that has affected us, is the fact that there's no clarity as to how your fiscal framework, how do we pay. Now, this act has produced a lot of clarity. There are issues around, for example, how do you separate oil and gas coming together? How do you measure them? So if you look at the fiscal instrument, it's very clear what you pay. And there are benchmarks to comparable economies and comparable oil industries. So what they have done with this is to provide operators a sense of certainty. And this is very important for a regulated business, and that's what they're moving from industry to regulated, you know, market, in which case the thing is about I wish we were paying what we're going to get. So the fiscal framework is very good, is better. There are things that are not that are still wrong with this bill or act. For example, mainstreaming the ministerial discretion in the work of the, especially the downstream and midstream regulatory authority, creates possible politicization of that process. Mm-hmm. For example, licensing of refineries mm-hmm. have too much of ministerial determination. It doesn't provide intelligible criteria how this should be made. So those are some of the, and you can understand why politicians would like to play into that. But on the whole, it's fair, it's a good enough if it's properly implemented and mitigated with some kind of protocols.
But shouldn't we be worried, you know, the so much ululation mm-hmm. over the passage of the PI, I mean, becoming an act is going to stabilize the industry, profitability, you know, good governance and what have you. The world is moving away from fossil fuels. Absolutely. Another 20, 30 years. What is the fate of Nigeria in this?
And that's my worry with the Frontier Exploration Fund. The impression is that you want to dig in. You know, it's like a
some cost. Oil
dig
in. Landers.
Exactly. We understand that they need to expand the reserve, you know, because, of course, while we transition to non-oil economy, we need to maximize earnings. This government is getting close to a point of being broke in a significant sense. So we need to expand our, you know, oil reserve. But again, you're right. But the focus of dedicating fund for exploration can create a sense of sunk cost. We keep on digging. So it's contradictory to, you know, a quick move away from fossil energy and from, you know, carbon-based economy. So basically the question is, will this become a kind of a disincentive to diversify the economy? It depends on how that process goes. Another point is regulatory framework. It's good to set up these agencies. How do I appoint people? Who do we appoint? How do we establish business rules?
That because government still controls.
If the government exactly, if the government makes the right decision and get the right kind of independent-minded market operators who run it as independent, as regulators who know their job, then it's get better. But as it's on paper, good enough. How do we implement? If you stack it with persons who are partisan, whose brief is to listen to the minister, then you create back the political risk that you know frustrates investment in this sector.
So, but do you expect any, you know, another round of maybe debates and even conflicts? Because it's looking
It's going to work. It will be there, but government can head it off with some kind of interventions, communications, the kind of things the governors are talking about. So if you reassure the governor, I think it was a mistake that when the governors wrote objected to the National Assembly, they would have had much more robust deliberation and find a way that the governors are taking care of the states. Mm. They wrote to the president, I don't think they gave too much consideration to that because the governors have a right to the Supreme Court as of right, you know, first start. So, and the legality around this is complex that you don't want the governors to hold back this act and that will send the strongest negative incentive, you know, signal to investors that even this much praised PIA has, you know, kind of, it's like on life support. So I think they should have gotten the governors comfortable enough before, you know,
carrying
both
them
passage and assent. At this point, it depends on the good sense of the governor. But I think they have some real concern that could have addressed through some better drafting of that.
Absolutely. The principles of fiscal federalism is key, really.
Absolutely.
Well, thanks so very much again. Associate Professor Sam Mamadi, you know, but sometimes we just get used to this doctor.
Well, I prefer that.
Okay, Sam Mamadi.
Sam Mamadi is a Rise News analyst. Thanks for coming on Newsline.